We're going to get to this place of calm and inner peace. But first, we need to explain to you all the things that are going to get in your way of reaping the full benefit of activities like meditation and mindfulness. And on that note, we're not going to talk about the three banks of intelligence this week. Instead, we're going to light the fuse on this podcast and start delivering on all the awesome promises that we made over the last 3 weeks. Today, we're going to start the process of teaching you how to eliminate negative emotions from your life forever. Oh yeah, get ready, because here we go. Welcome to the I Am Podcast, where we answer all the questions about spirituality and inner peace that you ever wanted to ask, and where we learn the secrets of humanity and divinity through a better understanding of both. Today, no more delays. The last few episodes, I've been holding out a carrot that you're soon going to understand spirituality like you never have before, including how you're going to learn to eliminate negative emotions from your life entirely. Well, today, we're going there. Here's how it's going to work. Yes, this is a spirituality podcast, but your ability to realize the beautiful truth of your spiritual existence is being blocked by your mind and all the crap that it creates to distract you from attaining inner peace. Some of this crap includes misconceptions about who and what you really are, spurious negative thought patterns, and yes, negative emotions. So, we're going to explain the process of how negative emotions get created within you. And why would we do that? Because if you can understand the process of how something gets created, you can break that process, and then whatever it is doesn't get created anymore. Now, negative emotions work the same way. When you understand the process of how they get created, you can break the process, then voila, no more negative emotions. And I'm not kidding. I have been living without negative emotional influence in my life for the last 10 years. I don't experience anger, fear, sadness, worry, regret, etc. the way other people do. I don't have fights with my wife. I've never had a harsh word towards her in almost 10 years of our relationship. In fact, I've never even once raised my voice. And she's only had to correct me a few times. I mean, come on, I am a man. What I'm about to explain to you basically explains how all emotions are created with 100% accuracy. And you'll not only agree with that statement when we're done, but you'll literally be blown away with how easy it is to understand and how easy it's going to be for you to implement this new emotional knowledge into your life moving forward. So, how emotions work. Within this section of the body-mind-spirit model, you're looking at everything that influences and creates human emotions within the mind. And we're going to cover how this stuff works in depth, but here's the way cool part. If you break any one of these individual components, the whole system of emotional turmoil comes crashing down around itself. If you break just one of the components in the model, no more negative emotions. Ever. Imagine how much better the world is going to be when millions of people start to remove negative emotions from their life. I am pumped. So let's go. Okay, so we have to cover all these pieces in depth, so we might as well start with the big shiny new one, the equation of emotion. Here is the equation. EP, which stands for expectation or preference, minus RP, which stands for an individual's reality as it's perceived, equals the ER, which is the resulting emotional response. Now, this may seem like a really simple equation to be able to explain all human emotion as complex as emotions can be, but it does. First, before getting all complex, let's look at how the equation of emotion works in its most basic of forms with one of the simplest scenarios that we can invent. Let's say you want a particular team to win a particular sports championship. So, bringing our equation out, your expectation or preference is that your team wins the game. So, if they do win the game, that fact becomes your reality, and because there is little or no difference between your expectation or preference and your perceived reality, you have a positive emotion that is the result. Now, let's say your team doesn't win the championship. Now, there's a greater difference between your expectation or preference and your reality that they lost, and a negative emotion becomes the result. And this is the basic foundation of how emotions work. When your perceived reality is close to your expectation or preference, you have a positive emotion. When your perceived reality is much different than your expectation or preference, you have a negative emotion. Getting a little more complicated now, how attached you are to your expectation or preference governs how powerful your emotional reaction is. If you just kind of like to see your team win, if they win, you're mildly happy. And congruently, if they were to lose, it's only a mild disappointment. But if you've attached your team to your definition of self, with the jerseys and the team colors and logos on the walls of your living room, then your attachment to the preference that they win becomes more powerful. And when they win, you feel the elation. But when they lose, you feel the utter despair. That's how some of the variables start to play into the different resulting emotions, because you'll remember that attachment is one of the mind's components. Different levels of attachment result in different emotions through the same one equation. Okay, so in our simple little example, let's break the equation of emotion for a second. Let's take the expectation or preference out and say you don't care who wins the championship. Let's say you're not even a fan of the sport. Well, now the equation is incomplete. The game is going to happen, so a reality as it's perceived, or RP, will exist, but because there's nothing to compare it to, because you don't have an expectation or preference, or EP, no emotional response is generated. Similarly, let's say you do care about who wins the game, but you can't watch the game and you're somewhere where you can't get the score. Now the game has happened, but you don't know the result, so there is no reality as it's perceived. So again, incomplete equation, so no emotional response is the result. And yes, not being able to get the score could be driving you nuts, but that's a different instance of the equation of emotion. What's important to notice here is that any time the equation of emotion is incomplete, no emotion can occur. So why don't we all just let go of all expectations or preferences in all situations? Wouldn't that remove all emotional turmoil from our lives? Well, yes, actually it would. It's not that simple, but theoretically, if you could do it, it would work. At any time the equation of emotion is incomplete, you will not have an emotional response. And this is partially what the Buddhists are talking about when they talk about separation from attachment. If you're not attached to any expectations or preferences, you can feel no emotional pain because the equation of emotion is incomplete. And I hear you. You're probably thinking, well, yeah, if I didn't care about anything, then I'd be apathetic about everything. And what fun would that be? I care about stuff. Well, there's a big difference between caring from the mind and caring from the spirit. Caring from the mind is selfish caring. You care about your politics, you care about your religion, you care about people who are connected with you. But caring from the spirit is a deeper and more profound caring than the mind could ever generate. It's boundless. And the compassion of the spirit's caring can occur without the negative aspects of the emotions that occur when the equation of emotion becomes unbalanced, when things don't come out as you prefer or expect. I care deeply for people, including you. But I do so from the spirit, which frees me up from being a slave of the equation of emotion. See, I broke the equation of emotion within me, and I didn't lose the capability to care deeply, or to love, or to experience joy. And you can too, if we finish this episode. Okay, so we can see how if the equation of emotion is incomplete, that emotions cannot occur. But there's a pretty long list of emotions, a lot more than are pictured here. So how can one simple subtraction problem account for all the various emotions that exist? Well, to answer that question, each emotion has a specific definition that is dependent on what is providing the variables for the equation of emotion. And although we're going to explain in a lot more detail how the entire system works as we move forward, this one basic equation of emotion does explain how all emotion is created within the mind. And there is no emotion that cannot be explained by it. And the really cool part is, because of that fact, there is no emotion that can't be controlled and even eradicated by properly manipulating the equation of emotion process. You never want to be sad again? It's going to take some work, but it can be done. You never want to be bothered by anger again, always keeping a level head in all situations? It is possible. This can do wonders for your career and your romantic relationships, by the way. You want to live a longer life because you reduce the level of stress in your body? Yeah. The equation of emotion holds the secrets on how to be able to bounce your great-grandkids on your knee for a few more years. Because medical studies prove that stress is the number one contributor to early deaths, by the way. Stress causes the high blood pressure, causes the heart disease, etc. This is huge, life-changing stuff, if you can get a handle on it. Okay, so for this week's homework, I want you to think back on the last memorable emotion that you had. Maybe it was a fight with your spouse, or maybe someone said something that hurt you recently. Whatever it was. Then I want you to analyze what your perceived reality was, your RP. How did you see that situation? And compare it to what your expectation or preference was for that situation. Because the difference between those two caused the emotional reaction that you had. And for the rest of the week, whenever you have a minor emotional reaction, stop and think, okay, what was the expectation or preference that I had that was different than what happened? And you'll start to see how your emotions are created within your mind. And this is a great tool, by the way, if you want to have a good discussion with your spouse. Honey, when you did this or you said that, my expectation or preference was X or Y, so I wound up feeling a little angry, hurt, whatever. Maybe next time we could fill in the blank. Then, homework part two, subscribe at iamspirituality.com so you don't miss the next week where we'll talk about one of the components that largely influences the equation of emotion and determines what emotions are created, by the way, and that also influences most of the decisions you make throughout your entire life. And don't forget to click the share buttons, please. Everyone needs help with emotions from time to time. Share the love so others can get on board and so we can make the world a better place of fewer negative emotions. Until then, see you next week. Peace.